Morning. Welcome back. Core mission crew right here in this room. And to day two of Interplanetary Post-COVID Voyager. And to introduce the introducer, I'm going to use our newest faculty member. And this is Professor Tesla. Yeah, and just so you know that just this came to our attention, Professor Tesla's work, because I got an email and Professor Tesla had found a big mistake in Andrew Weil's proof of the Fermat conjecture on page 22. And he made a mistake, right?
A horrible mistake.
Yeah, a horrible mistake. And if you don't know this, Andrew Weil's used modular forms to try and solve the conjecture. And Tesla used
the spaghetti form.
Spaghetti form that turned out to be vastly more powerful. So anyway, give it up! Give it up to Tesla!
Thank you. First of all, I would like to thank Mr. David for introducing me. And welcome to the second day of the third Interplanetary Festival. We hope you enjoy it. I will now hand the microphone off to my dad.
Thank you, Tesla. So yeah, welcome back for day two. I guess that's actually a good segue to remind especially the folks who might be watching at home with parent duties that this is by far the most child-friendly of all the events that SFI puts on. So there's face painting and Cheerios and all sorts of kid science experiments that we did yesterday. And so if you have kids and you're watching this, feel free to come on down. I think Interplanetary is great, and David mentioned a lot of the sort of intellectual contributions that it makes to the SFI mission yesterday, but one that I just want to touch on in particular in advance of our first panel, there's an increasing body of research that says that when we evaluate political policies, we do it not based on some sort of rational evaluation of the policy as much as sort of the alignment with our partisan affiliation with different political orientations and identities that people might have. One of the great things about Interplanetary, it allows us to discuss policies in a domain that is so far removed from the sort of partisan political battles that we find ourselves mired in, that we can really focus not on the ideological, but on the epistemological inquiries into these ideas. As many of you know, SFI recently got a large institute-level grant for emergent political economies. We're going to be looking at a lot of these issues, and so that need to sort of, you know, distance ourselves from the ideological and focus on epistemological views of these ideas is becoming more important and more prescient, and really just sort of underscores the value that IP brings to what we're doing. In addition to giving us an opportunity to explore these ideas, the Emergent Political Economy grant has also put us in touch with a large number of new cool people, and that's something that's going to be continuing over the next 5 years. One of the first of them is our new program manager, Travis Holmes, who's going to be moderating the first panel. And with that, Travis, let me bring you up to introduce the rest of the panel.
Should I use this one or this one here already? Okay. Thank you. Hello. Good morning, everyone. Thanks for coming. I appreciate you all being here. So I'm super excited about this panel, and if you will give me, this is a very diverse panel, and if you give me a moment, I'd like to kind of frame the discussion that I think we're going to have. I'm really actually very pleased that Will introduced it the way that he did, because he kind of took the words right out of my mouth in a certain sense, which is really good for the future of the project, I think. So let me tell you a little bit about how I want to frame this and how I want to think about this. So as an anthropologist, I've always been interested in how environmental constraints shape behavior. And I think I'm particularly interested in this notion of what's known as spatially territorialized notions of culture, right? Now, this is in juxtaposition to what we're currently experiencing and what we've been experiencing in terms of globalization, where there's this massive deterritorialization that's going on because of the flows of information and people and money and all of these things, right? So in large part, this is, I think, or at least it made me think of the 60s and 70s and the counter-revolutions, right? This was kind of their argument in a certain sense, is that there's a certain way that we've always looked at things or that we're culturally constrained to look at things, right? But if we think about them different ways, it opens up a space for theorizing about how they can be different. And so that's kind of what how I think about the Emergent Political Economies program. And so I want to frame this, actually, we were supposed to have a panelist here. Her name is Timiabi Aganaba, and she's actually a space lawyer. And I want to specifically take her self-description. So she describes herself as a British-Canadian Nigerian outer space lawyer, which I think is one of the coolest titles ever. But she was on. I was watching some of her videos in preparation when I spoke with her before, and she was being interviewed. And they asked her. She was part of. I should give a little background first. So she was part of a newly formed agency for the country of Nigeria to have a space program. And so she was a newly graduate lawyer, and they charged her with having the policy of like figuring out all this. And there was someone in the audience that asked her a question. I thought it was really interesting. They were asking her why she thought that Nigeria, a country that was, you know, relatively poor with a lot of problems, why do you think that Nigeria should have a space program? And I loved her answer, and I'm gonna quote her here. "It's important because if you spend all of your time thinking about poverty alleviation, you will never develop because there will always be these problems." And I thought this was really interesting, right? The first thing it made me think of was JFK's speech, right? "We choose to go to the moon," right? And this idea that we were in the midst of a Cold War, you could argue, why were we doing it then, right? I mean, of course, there were some wartime implications of this as well, but it also kind of, I think when we retrospectively look back at this conversation, at this speech, we think about the imagination that it required, right? In the midst of all that turmoil, to say that, no, this is an important thing for the human condition at large, right? And so the point of this, I think, is it's interesting that depending on your environmental context or the country that you come from, there'll be different assumptions about what you should or should not do. And that's why I was so inspired by Timiyimbi's quote, how she answered that question. So I think, without further ado, I'm not gonna introduce them. I believe in people introducing themselves. And so I'm gonna let everyone on the panel kind of introduce themselves in the way that they want to. And then we're gonna have a discussion about some pretty interesting things, not about economics per se, or about space per se, but about some of the more underlying social and philosophical implications of being in space, and how we can then reflect on our current world that we're living in on Earth, right? So whoever wants to go first, please.
Hello, my name is Kelly Dine. I'm a postdoc at the Santa Fe Institute, and I'm a historian and philosopher of biology. So I focus a lot on the concept of information and behavioral experiments, and anything historical, philosophical happening at that intersection. A new sort of area I've been getting into over the last year that I think may be relevant to the discussion we're about to have is biobanking, especially indigenous biobanking. So there's been a sort of gold rush on indigenous genomic biodata lately, and I think that's interesting sort of for a number of reasons maybe we'll get into.
Good morning. My name is Ian Tregillis. In my day job, I'm a physicist at Los Alamos, but I think more relevant to the proceedings this weekend, I'm also a genre writer. I'm the author of 7 science fiction novels. Certainly the oddball on this panel. I don't have a background in biology or economics or sociology or history, so I look forward to learning from my wise colleagues today.
Ian, there's some pretty stiff competition to be the oddball. My name is Kyle Harper. I'm a historian. I'm trained as a historian of the ancient world, of the Romans. Despite what you see on Ancient Aliens and the History Channel, the Romans never left Earth and never had contact with anyone beyond the Earth. So I don't know what that means about my credentials for talking about what's next, but I like to think about the big picture of human history. What can we know about the big dynamics that drive innovation, change, transformation in the human past, and how might knowing that inform the way we look to the future?
Yeah, great, thank you. So yeah, so as Will said, the beauty of these kinds of panels, and especially at Interplanetary Festival.
Introduce yourself.
Oh, so I'm Travis Holmes. I'm the manager of the Emergent Political Economies program. As I said, my background is in anthropology and international studies. I've done some ethnographic work in both China. I spent 2.5 years in China doing ethnographic work there, and also in Oaxaca, Mexico. And so from these kind of experiences that I had, I became very, very interested in how different people live. Particularly, I think what it made me think about is the assumptions that I bring with me going to these other you know, cultures and these other places, and how they would ask me all the time, you know, why do Americans do this or why do Americans do that? And for to be totally honest with you, I didn't always have an answer, right? So this is something that's kind of ingrained in us culturally, and so those are the kind of questions that I'm interested in. So as you can see, we don't have any economists on this panel about space economy, but I think that's a good thing. And the reason why is because I do really want to come to this topic with a kind of childlike attitude, right? And so I did, I think, what any undergraduate would do maybe if they were interested in economics and ask the question, you know, what is the economy? And so I think I wanted to just read this really quickly, the definition of economy for you. So the definition that I just looked up was thrifty management, frugality in the expenditure or consumption of money or materials, an act or means of thrifty saving, and the management of the resources of a community, country, especially with a view to its productivity, right? So you can see from this, you know, definition, if I was an alien or if I was someone who just came into contact with this discipline, you know, there's assumptions built into this, right? And particularly, I had a conversation with Sam Bowles, and he was talking about how, you know, he wants to change this paradigm that economists look at the economy as just scarcity, right? This idea that everything is scarce, and so we have to maximize and efficientize everything, right? So what I want to ask you today is, you know, what is your perspective based on your respective works? You know, what do you view as the economy? Or if you don't have one from your work, what is just your assumptions about the economy? Anybody want to go first? All right, so I think we'll start with Kelly.
Sure. Yeah, so I was thinking about this. I'm not an economist. What would I say is the economy? What's the basis of it? And I just think about people needing and wanting things, part of the basis of value, and that sort of remains the most mysterious part of the economy, as opposed to the part where you enter into a group and somehow interact with others to satisfy those needs and wants, which is sort of much more eminently quantifiable because of money. So when we go into space, I mean, I think we already have a sort of loose grasp scientifically on what a human want is or how desire works. Except I think that one thing we know about it is that what people want or desire depends on the context, depends on their environment. People largely, I think, aren't born knowing what to want. They have to be shown what to want. And I wonder what will happen when we go into a radically different environment like space, and how that might affect the things people need and want, and how that in turn is going to perhaps radically change the conception of the economy.
You know, this is going to sound flippant, but as a genre writer, sometimes to me, economy is the thing that gives me a headache when I worry that readers are going to come up to me and say, "I don't really understand how the economy works in this fictional world that you built." So I take sort of an arm's length approach to sketching out, you know, markets and economies in my books, at least in places where I'm depicting a radically changed world, say in an alternate history. So I sort of approach it in the way that Kelly just described, where I think about the flow of wants and needs and the flow of resources driven by various agendas. You know, there are writers like, I always think of Charlie Strauss as someone who really, really enjoys delving into various economic theories and practices in his work. For me, you know, I feel like it's just the bear trap sitting there waiting for, I worry that, you know, every chapter I write, I'm laying down more bear traps, and then someday I'm just going to step in them, and they're going to grab me. But that's life as a writer, I guess.
I think we could start by asking what's our sort of shared assumption about what an economy is. And I mean, one way to think of it is it's the kinds of activities and enterprises that would be covered in the Wall Street Journal. It's about production. It's about finance. Stocks, interest rates, valuations, labor, capital. It's sort of those things, and we kind of know where they are in our society. Here's where I do think economic history can be helpful, because For a century, economic historians have had the same argument. Sometimes it can get very dull and tiresome, but actually sometimes it can be very generative over whether it's appropriate to talk about economies in the past, whether that's kind of a modern construction to put together finance and production and equities and so on. And there's sort of one view that's completely wrong. This is sometimes called the substantivist view, that societies are really embedded in cultures, and economies are embedded in societies and cultures. And then there's the kind of neoclassical view that it's still useful to think about production and scarcity in these historical cases. And so there's actually a lot to both of these arguments. But where I think it can be helpful is that ideas about what the economy is change, clearly. And one of the most important reasons why they change is because the sort of underlying basis through which a society manages scarce resources like energy and minerals really fundamentally shapes where an economy is, how we relate to it as workers, as traders. And I think that when we think about becoming an interplanetary civilization, that we're likely talking about a revolution as transformational as any of the earlier changes in the way human societies have subsisted. So the transition from foraging to farming, or from farming to mineral-based energy and industrial production. When we talk about becoming extra or interplanetary, we're talking about a revolution in the way that energy and materials flow through our world that will probably change the way we relate to one another in ways that are as profound as those earlier revolutions.
Yeah, great. So thank you for your answers. I think that I wanted to do this exercise right at the beginning because I wanted to make clear that there are so many different conceptions of the economy, right? Depending on where you live, who you are, what culture you come from. And so I wanted to start very broad, but now I want to go to some more specific topics. So I want to share with you this headline that I saw on CNN the other day. And I want you to all comment on what you think about this. So this is an article about CNN about there are approximately 100 million pieces of space junk floating around low Earth orbit, and it's becoming a serious problem. So interestingly, the FCC made a statement, and I want to read it to you. So, or this is the headline that refers to this. Out-of-service satellites must be removed within 5 years, FCC says. Right? So I think this is a hilarious headline, right? Because you have several things in here, right? First of all, who is going to remove these satellites? Who has the jurisdiction? Who has the responsibility to do this? How will it be enforced? They must be removed. And then, of course, I think the most ironic thing, FCC says, which is an American institution, right? But when we're talking about space economy, right, it's inherently going to be this shared space, right? I mean, it's a vast space, obviously, but even when it comes to the closest orbit to our own planet, right, we're already framing this in terms of nations, right, or responsibility and jurisdiction and institutions that are based in nation states. So how do you think that we can, or what do you think about this, or do you think there's a better way of doing this?
You want to go the other way? That's fine. When I hear that headline, it doesn't need saying that I'm not a space lawyer. We lost our space lawyer. I'd love to hear what she thinks. But as a historian, that sounds a lot like me, to me, like the Pope telling the European powers to be nice as they start expanding beyond Europe in the 16th, 17th century. You have this very legacy set of institutions and power arrangements that everyone sort of has to use because you can't see the future, you can't necessarily design for a future that doesn't exist. And so you're sort of working within these institutional structures that have evolved and that have a certain amount of intelligence and adaptation built into them, but are then suddenly wildly unprepared and arguably inadequate for the kind of new challenges that are at hand. So I think, you know, a religious leader telling nation states that all of a sudden have guns and capitalist and imperialist ambitions to behave a certain way is sort of what it sounds like to have an American communications federal agency saying to the world, you clean up after yourselves when you make a mess in near orbit. So I think it does strike us that we know probably somewhere deep down that there are going to be institutional changes in governance that that we can be confident are going to happen and need to happen, but are hard to foresee, and it's very hard to design institutions. So I think it does provoke a whole range of questions about how can we manage this transition in ways that are fair, that are efficient, and that maybe do draw from the past. Because if we again look at these huge revolutions in the way human societies have subsisted and acquired energy, we know that those transitions have often been accompanied by a mix of progress and terrible violence. And so you mentioned the rise of the nation state. That's an example that in some ways is progressive and leads to more rational forms of politics, perhaps, but also is accompanied by tremendous violence internally and externally. So we of course, have room to imagine, and so much science fiction helps us sort of imagine those possibilities, but I think history can, too, and to remind us the spectrum of what human societies are capable of when they're confronted with these kinds of huge new opportunities and new challenges.
Yeah, and I actually want to follow up with you a little bit more on that, but before I do that, is there anybody else that wants to comment?
The impetus behind that, I guess I'll call it an edict from the FCC, which does not have jurisdiction over the globe, this recognition that the low Earth orbit is, and I guess all the way out to geostationary orbit, is a finite resource, really. I think there's sort of what I hear in that edict is sort of this lone voice in the wilderness saying, you know, we really need to start worrying about space junk, and we really need to worry about the fact that this is the amount of space in Earth orbit is not infinite, and so there's a voice of reason in that, but I think it's coming too late and it's too quiet. There are the technical problems of how you deorbit a satellite. How do you deorbit a satellite that was launched by a foreign country, right? I'm not a space lawyer either. I have no idea. Is that legal? So I think it's a too little too late in trying to deal with a resource that was where the prevailing attitude has been sort of a very Wild West kind of thing where you just launch what you want to launch and everyone has to deal with your decisions. There's a MacArthur Genius Grant recipient at the University of Texas named Mori Bajá, I believe, and he talks about sort of advocating for sort of a paradigm shift where people should think about Earth orbit as an ecosystem, even though there's not necessarily anything living up there. But insofar as that gets people to think about it as a valuable resource that can be exploited and destroyed. That should be made sustainable. So I think that's what I hear when the FCC says this. I think it's strange. It's weird that it's coming from this federal communications agency, but at least someone's thinking about it.
Yeah, we'll just say that thinking about it as a valuable environment or ecology is nice, because when I hear that headline, the first question I think is, what's going to happen? You know, is there a big stick the FCC has to hurt someone? And then that just leads you down a train of thought that's so sort of depressing and banal of, you know, might makes right, conquering people, treating each other poorly. Yeah. The historian knows.
So it's interesting that you bring that up, because I was reading a little bit more of the article. It's interesting how the FCC frames it to Congress when they presented this, right? And the way they framed it was, we need to do this not because of some social good or anything like this. It's because there's going to be increased privatization of space, right? And as that happens, if lower Earth orbit becomes so congested with satellites, that's actually going to cost jobs. That's the way they framed it. So I thought that was interesting. And it's
really? Because yeah. I mean, you could argue, like, there's the argument for enlightened self-interest, right? Because there's the concern that, and this has already begun to happen, right? When satellites start colliding with each other, right? You get a spray of debris, and that debris can go off and hit other things, and you get this thing called a Kessler cascade, right? And eventually, the theory is that eventually, you can't put any new satellites up, and that space becomes unusable. It becomes technologically unusable. So that's interesting. I did not think about the the jobs issue, that's a very tenuous argument, isn't it? Right.
Well, I think it speaks to how maybe unprepared we are for the space, and I think that we're in the process of figuring this all out, right? And so I want to give, did you want to say something? Oh, okay. So I wanted to give another example, right? This is governance in general, but another thing that we discussed earlier was about law. And actually, Ian, you brought up this story in Antarctica, right? So part of one way that I know that NASA and other scientists have tried to figure out, well, how will we survive in space and how will we, you know, navigate, you know, the harshness of the environment is by going to Antarctica. And there was a story that you shared with me, Ian, about a murder that occurred in Antarctica. And they couldn't decide because this was on a temporary ice island that had formed.
Yeah, it was in the Arctic in 1970. I really wish Tamibi was here because we need a space lawyer. So in 1970 there was a temporary research outpost on an ice floe way up in the Arctic. There was a fight over someone's personal jug of homemade raisin wine, which sounds disgusting, but you know, when you're there in the Arctic, it's, you know. And so there was an argument. Someone got shot and died. And it became this huge jurisdictional headache because it wasn't clear whether or not the accused murderer could even be tried. Because the ice floe was, the nearest landmass was Canada, but outside of Canadian territorial waters. So it wasn't Canada's problem. The research outpost was run by the United States Air Force, but the accused was a civilian, so he couldn't be court-martialed. So then people argued, well, it's this ice floe out on the sea, so maybe the law of the sea applies. But apparently, again, not a lawyer, apparently the law of the sea only applies on vessels that are navigable, and they were on a Manhattan-sized iceberg, so not really navigable, so that didn't apply. And then there was the argument, well, you know, like a country could come in and claim it, and then their jurisprudence would apply. But apparently, the way countries fought over the Guano Islands in the southern hemisphere. But apparently, that only works for permanent structures. And it was known that this ice floe was going to melt and disappear, and it did in the 80s. So the idea of like territorially claiming something also didn't apply. So it was like a ball in a pachinko machine, like falling through every crack. Yeah, it got very complicated. And then the way they eventually brought this guy to trial was very hinky because wasn't even sure where you would do it. Just fell through every crack.
They brought him to Virginia, and they tried him in Virginia because that was literally the first place they landed.
But it wasn't, because to get back, first they had to go to Greenland.
That's right.
And they just kind of overlooked the fact that they actually stopped in Greenland for a while. Yeah. So it was all very questionable. But the point is that people have looked at this case apparently as a bellwether for space law in the future, because in fact, in the end, he ended up getting acquitted. So like there was no legal precedent established by this whole, you know, circus.
Mm-hmm. Anybody else? Okay. Well, we can move on to our next topic. The second one I wanted to talk about was actually information, right? So information is a very important topic in economics. So for example, it makes me think of George Akerlof's paper about the market for lemons, and how asymmetric information can actually influence the value of products, right? And so when I think about this in terms of, I mean, I remember, Kelly, you were talking about how people in what, you know, your background in information, about how people used information differently. And I'm thinking that, well, if I want to buy a car from you, right, we have a social interaction and we can kind of figure out bargain, whatever the case may be. But when it comes to space, that's going to change. And so how do you, you know, in your understanding of information, you know, what is your perception of how information can or should or shouldn't be used when it comes to a different environment where there's such a huge time lapse potentially between social interaction?
Yeah, what I think of, and this is where the biobanking stuff comes in, is how the sort of rationale behind even building an institution like a biobank is that data is valuable, but we sort of don't know how valuable. It's undetermined. And so we should just grab stuff that we think is likely to be valuable and wait, because as theory and practice sort of evolve over time, we find ways to use things that we never knew about before. So in like a forensic context, for instance, maybe a detective finds a blood sample. And in that moment, I don't know the history of this. Let's say the 70s or something, it might be like, okay, well, this is data about blood type. Fast forward to now, it's going to be data about something else. The content changes as our abilities change. And so I wonder, in a place like space where time can become sort of a vast variable in which different people could be separated by huge expanses of time, how the value of data is going to be valued in that kind of context. Are there going to be sort of like biobanks everywhere and people sort of not knowing, perpetually ignorant of what the real value is, because maybe somewhere a long distance or a long time away from them, you know, they've already developed the methods to do something special with this?
Anyone else?
Okay. I'll jump in a little bit. I mean, people obviously use information to mean very different things. When I think about it in terms of the way you're asking the question, I think you're getting at the kind of way that information plays a really critical role in coordinating human economies, in coordinating production, consumption, flowing through markets more or less efficiently and symmetrically. Or asymmetrically. And I think that's, that's an interesting way to think about interplanetary civilization, because one of the driving themes of human societies in modern times is greater and faster movements of information, whether we're thinking about computational abilities or they're thinking about communications, all of which allow greater integration of humans into a coordinated environment, coordinated economy. This has been one of the, to me, really shocking lessons of COVID-19. Even as somebody who thinks about the history of pandemics and thinks about the history of economies, there have been some things during COVID-19 where I thought we knew that was going to happen. We should have known all along. There are other things that I still struggle to wrap my mind around. And one is obviously just the incredible fragility of global capitalist supply chains. It's really been something that's shocked me, and it's affected, every one of our lives in some way or another, from something as trivial, like it taking 18 months to get a couch, which is kind of a personal issue for me, to far more serious disruptions to our lives. So we've built a world that depends on the flow of good information to coordinate production and consumption. And we have this little, relatively in the scheme of things, when you think of the history of pandemics, this shock to the system that has affected everything else, because everything is connected. We still haven't fully got over it. So it makes you worry about if we become interplanetary and we build the platforms that we think function, where are going to be their sources of fragility or stress that are prone to disruption?
I'm glad you brought that up, because that's actually, I was going to put you on the spot next. I know you've done research on the fall of Rome. And particularly, I was interested in, you were talking about the intersection between disease, population, economy, climate, state. Now, all of these things aren't going to necessarily apply, or maybe they will in some other way, in the interplanetary form. But I'm wondering what you learned about the fall of Rome that could tell us about how we could fix our institutions now, which then would give us some insights into what institutions we would need in a different kind of environment.
Well, it's a hard question. It's one I've thought a lot about. The world that we live in is very, very different from the world of a large-scale agrarian empire that's built on an economy that's essentially dependent on farming for its production, and that is built on certain kind of pre-modern institutions of empire. But I think there are still certain kind of insights that we might take. I wouldn't say that the Romans did anything that we should particularly emulate in trying to build an interplanetary civilization. But what their story and other historical cases do, I think, help us understand is the way that complex human systems are sometimes subject to these shocks. Things can change faster than anyone expected, particularly when you start to get interlinked systems with feedbacks between them breaking down. And so the Roman Empire was, in many respects, very, very resilient. They were used to all sorts of perturbation, but then there are these moments where the external perturbation becomes so great that the systems start to sort of fold in on one another. So Rome thinks it has an eternal empire, and for a long time it looks like they've made a strong case, and then relatively suddenly things can change. So I think we know far more, we have more information about the way the environment that we live in works, how to manipulate it technologically. We shouldn't be stressed by the same kinds of perturbations that they were. At the same time, I think the message can be that human systems can change very, very rapidly for better and for worse, and that people are often very, very bad at foreseeing that, at least before the fact. That really in these situations, the hardest thing to understand, the hardest thing to explain, and the most dangerous thing of all is the way that the humans behave towards each other. So, climate and pandemic disease didn't make the Roman Empire fall. It made the Roman Empire do things that made them fall. And I think we can think in parallel terms about any of the big challenges we face, whether it's climate change or becoming extra planetary. What scares me, isn't so much the direct effects of global warming by 2 degrees. It's what that's going to make humans do to each other. I think that's one thing that history can help us understand.
Yeah, absolutely. And also, I wanted to ask you, Ian, since you literally build worlds, right? I think that you might have an interesting take on, the imaginative exercise. But when you're thinking about, I suppose, when you're writing your novels, right? It's not an exact reflection of human society, right? It's a bit of an extension or an imagination about what things could be or what they could look like. And so I don't know if you have any thoughts on this.
I don't think anyone has ever accused me of building a wildly realistic world or adhering to anything even remotely realistic. So if I were to take what Kyle just said as a jumping off point for, okay, I'm gonna build some society, I'm gonna envision some society, some interplanetary society. It's hard for me to imagine like interplanetary empire, right? I see, and maybe this is the pessimist in me, but I see the problem of survival and subsistence being so overwhelming that the idea of having a society where you have anything beyond just scrabbling for survival every day, very, very difficult. In a more compact, centralized empire where you can have agriculture and then the development of wealth and the distribution of goods, that's sort of the model that we all see in our heads. Even people like me who are not deeply rooted in the history, but it's very hard for me to imagine how you get beyond that first step of, how do we have any free energy left to do anything beyond surviving, right? So that would be, for me, in the world building, that would be the intellectual challenge of building something that I actually believed, or I thought that I could trick other people into believing when they're reading the book.
Yeah, so you make me think of something else, and maybe it's interesting the way that we're currently talking about space exploration, right? I mean, of course, there's a pure scientific endeavor into it, but obviously with the rise of SpaceX and Elon Musk, right, there's a lot more talk about the commercialization of space. And for me, this brings up a bit of a paradox, right, in that we see space as both scarce but also potentially the new wave of the economy, right? And the idea that we can go to different planets or, meteors or asteroids and kind of mine the resources that are there. And so it makes me think, if this is the conversations that are driving our, how we talk about space exploration outside of the scientific realm, how can we expect to have an equitable society? Or what would we need to do to think about equitable economics in space? Anybody have any comments on that? I'm asking hard questions today.
That's a hard question. I will maybe try and speak about what we would want to know about the past to inform that conversation, which you raised Elon Musk's name and have mentioned a few times, privatization and commercialization. I think there's some interesting parallels that I hadn't thought of until we were up here on stage between the role of these organizations that are very hard for historians to define, like the Dutch East India Company, because they're novel kinds of human organization that are able to pool capital in ways that are very, very effective in their world and ultimately change the world. They function more or less as states, even though they're really not. They're chartered by states, but they have certain kinds of sovereignty and power that resemble states. They of course, are associated with exchange and trade and coordination and resource movement at the same time as exploitation and violence. And it's interesting to think, you know, what are the parallels with the role that private corporations are playing in pooling capital in order to lead us across into these new resource frontiers? Are we thinking enough about what that has done in the past and ways we can maybe do that better? Because you know, the early modern trading companies were very, very powerful, and partly because they filled a gap that existing largely feudal monarchies were not filling. But the kind of next step in that story is radical institutional change that was unforeseen, because the modern world also ushers in the nation state and replaces the kind of medieval feudal political order. So are there ways in which becoming an interplanetary civilization will have parallel effects in so radically transforming the way that humans think of the kind of societies that they belong to? Nobody in the 15th or 16th century is sitting there saying, once we go through these revolutions and economy and society over the next few hundred years, we're all going to live in nation states. Nobody designed that. It emerges out of struggles over power and philosophical debates as well. Is there something out there that's truly difficult for us to envision that's somewhere taking shape as Elon starts to colonize other planets? What if he does, gets there first, and not just him, but a private company that's more powerful than national governments? I mean, that has happened before. And I think it'd be hubristic to think that that is at all unrealistic. And how will that affect people's sense of their identity? There are maybe optimistic ways to think that that as we sort of move beyond our own planet, it opens up ways that we can conceive of ourselves as humans in a sense that's progressive, and maybe seeing the littleness of our planet and will remind us how closely related we are to each other, but to every thing that lives on this planet. But at the same time, we know that these kinds of moments of exploration have also brought out the worst in humanity in the past too. And if there's a scramble for resources and it's not clear who's in charge, and the FCC or the Pope is sitting down here on Earth and saying, Elon, don't take Mars. But if he's got the resources to do it, and I'm not singling him out, it'll probably happen after him. But we should not have the expectation that things like that can't happen.
Well, it reminds me of, when we look at a lot of, I guess, space movies, that science fiction novels and movies that are looking at the future, I feel like a recurrent institution that always comes up are like mining colonies, right? There's always some planet that has a mining colony and they have workers that they've imported from other planets or from, Earth, where other people, civilizations are, right? And so I guess this is where, I suppose, the fear that I have about when the way that we're talking about space. And this is what I think that Team Yebi does so well, is she's kind of trying to make sure that doesn't happen, right? To look at institutions we have on Earth and say, hey, these are the kinds of things we need to think about. We can't just think about, oh, there's resources on that planet, so what is the best way to make that an efficient trade or an efficient way to capitalize on whatever resources are there?
We'll say Kyle was just saying had me thinking about history as science. And there is precedent, not just from the actual history, but from popular culture and movies, that scientists tend to be the kinds of people who are easily plied and who are kind of happy to focus on the thing they're interested in. And so it's Elon Musk, the new dictator, funding my trip to Mars, or you know, whatever, as long as I'm getting the data I care about and I'm solving the problems that I want to solve. And so that is in our history to think about whether we want to recapitulate what happened, I guess, in some called age of exploration, age of colonization, this part of the history of science. Is it going to be like that again?
Your mention of the Dutch East India Company is very interesting to me. I know less than a thimbleful about the Dutch East India Company, but it gets me thinking about what is the parallel. I mean, is there a missing step, right? When we go, if I'm going to put words in your mouth because this isn't what you were saying, but it got me thinking. If you think of that as a model for how things might progress, in a move towards a extra Earth or interplanetary society, the Dutch East India Company was able to become extremely powerful because it, this sort of semi-autonomous, I don't know what you want to call it, this company, this economic cartel, assumed control of resources that were so valuable that the whole practice was viable, right? It was viable to build ships and sail halfway around the world and exploit the spice islands, the spices, the chattel slavery. Like, what is the parallel as we try to get off of Earth? Like, it has to be, the expenditure of resources has to be worthwhile, right? I that's the part that I'm struggling with. Like, if you're going up to build a mining colony, you find a metal-rich asteroid in the asteroid belt. Are you going to mine all that iron and then send it back down the gravity well? That's such a waste of energy. Like, you need there's like a step in infrastructure. It seems like you need enough infrastructure in orbit so that you're not still firing giant chemical rockets to get up and down. Does my question make sense? Like, what would the parallel be in space?
I'm thinking, what would be the scarce resources that would be valuable?
Water
here
and air.
Or there? And might be things we take for granted. We might instantly, our mind might run to energy and to other maybe sources of mineral wealth. Or I mean, the entire system of global exploitation that emerges in the 16th, 17th century is driven in ways that nobody had foreseen. The number one driver is sugar, right? I mean, just like the most powerful propulsive. Now, it's, you could say gold, but gold quickly gets sidelined by sugar. You have this addictive, psychotropic food that we all now absolutely depend on. And as a parent of four children, you know, I can't imagine, without the negotiating power of sugar, how anyone ever raised children. To me, it's one of those scary facts of history. Like, people didn't used to consume sugar. I tell my students this all the time. You think about the Romans, they didn't have coffee. They didn't have sugar. Like, how did they get through that day? I can't even imagine. But part of the making of the modern world, humans, you know, change because of the things we're consuming and the way we relate to the environment. And the rise of psychotropic addictive commodities changes the world. So it can be very hard to foresee. But I loved what you said. I hadn't gone there yet, but it's an obviously scary and potentially good answer. Oxygen and water. If we really do screw up this planet, then things that we may take for granted that are essential to our metabolism and bodies will suddenly look very, very different in terms of their value. So I don't necessarily know what I would put my money on it being, but I think it's easy to think that there could be resources that generate value that allow the exploration of other explanatory resources by actors that we might not ultimately like, even if they fund our research.
It's becoming very Philip K. Dick, thinking about sort of the most valuable resource in space being some sort of psychotropic drug or something. But this is what I was getting at with the people need to be shown what to want. You know, it's an interaction with the environment. They're not just born fully formed with wants like the sugar thing.
Yeah. Great. Well, I want to be respectful of time, and I think we have about 5 minutes left. So are there any questions from the audience that we can get to? All right. Looks like I saw. Okay.
Thanks. This is a really interesting talk. Just a side note about the sugar, there's this amazing book called 1 Minute After that imagines what would happen if there was an IMF attack, and coffee beans become currency. So, good theory. I think we're probably in a moment where we're about to, like these multinational corporations, yeah, I'm also taken with this East India Company thing, and I think we're probably about to see this giant organizational form shift. And I wonder, I know you're a historian, so you're not in the business of casting forward, but we learned yesterday that in some ways of looking at it, time is symmetric. So what do you think those forms might look like? Kyle and maybe Ian, his thoughts, or anyone?
Yeah, this is where I say I'm a historian, not a futurist. But I think one point I would make is that what happens in, say, the shift from medieval to modern times with the fundamental change of say the energy system towards fossil mineral energy, is it also changes the way people think of their belonging to communities in ways that nobody had foreseen. And so, if you're a medieval villager, you know you might think of yourself as sort of a subject within a kingdom, and that's totally different from thinking of yourself as a citizen of a modern nation state, where we tend to think that we have some kind of social contract. We're participants in a polity. What lies ahead may look really, really different, and it may be that that we think it's more voluntary. Imagine, you know, if SpaceX sets up a calls it a nation state, but it's really some kind of totally new institutional formation where people really can kind of choose whether you go or you stay here. You know, how does that change citizenship or belonging or power relationships? Those things are, in the big picture, very, very hard to predict. But they also, I think we should recognize too, in history, they change at different paces, sometimes fast, sometimes slow, and very often by changes to things that already exist. So I mean, the British system is really still has all of its kind of feudal forms that have just been essentially modernized. And I think it may be the case that some of what we think of as being the institutional forms that we live under may sort of survive, but they may be so radically different that if you transported a British subject of the king from the 17th century to today, they wouldn't really recognize much beyond the kind of outward symbols and forms in terms of the substance of what it meant to be a citizen. So maybe what lies ahead as an interplanetary civilization is just as radical, and it's hard for us to conceive of what citizenship might look like.
I think, do we have time for one more?
Yeah, great. So, drawing on science fiction, right? Another thing that comes up a lot in that is that these environments that we take with us are an encapsulation of everything that supports us on this planet. And when you're talking about the scarcities that avail themselves as we move into these hostile environments, I'm thinking of films like Ad Astra, where the Mars base has these screens around all the rooms that are trying to replicate Earth-like living environments for people that are trapped in this like horrible, basically like military prison installation, and trying to make it through their day. And you know, we're gonna be ensconced in these shells of robotics and automated processes. And so, you know, like, it's gonna be, there's like two things I'd love to hear anybody up there address, one of which is the change in the way that we're gonna think about labor and labor relations in such highly automated environments, but environments where, you know, either it's owned remotely in some sort of, you know, giant corporate empire sense, or it's not, in like a Kim Stanley Robinson sense, you know, where these bases are too far away to be effectively governed, and so they end up, you know, staging a revolt or whatever and claiming the means of production. And then the other is a bit more subtle, and it's about the what might change for us in the way that we relate to one another due to the like compulsory modification of the human being in order to survive in these hostile environments, you know. So I don't know if either of those questions finds a hook in anybody up there, but yeah, thank you.
What you mentioned about Kim Stanley Robinson, definitely, I mean, he got there before me, for sure. But I subscribe to sort of the train of thought that you will have tiny settlements that are so widely separated that there's no, that is implausible to have like an overarching system that governs them. So, you know, I'm really kind of a bitter nihilist, and so I just see that being very anarchic. But if going back to the Dutch East India model, you know, if you have these extremely powerful sort of autocratic, semi-autonomous agencies, that's another trope in science fiction where you have this basically autonomous corporate entity that takes a very draconian and sort of militaristic to impose order on this fundamentally anarchic system. It's not hard for me to extrapolate from whatever the successor to like the SpaceX will be, could take that path, because you need those kinds of that accumulation of resources to be able to do something like colonize Mars. But for-profit enterprises are sort of fundamentally sociopathic, I think. So that's my nihilism at work.
All right. I think that's the end of that's about all the time we have. So thank you very much.
I think we have still a few more minutes if you wanted to keep going.
Sorry?
Yeah,
I think we can do one or two more.
Oh, yeah. Oh, great. All right, perfect. You in the middle, you've been having your hand up for a while, and then maybe we can get it written.
In the beginning, it will take a lot of resources to establish anything, a colony or mining colony, whatever, in space. So it'll take the air and the water. If you're up there in a spacesuit, you have an appendectomy, you're going to have medical care. Everything's going to have to come from here to get up there. It's going to take an immense, enormous amount of resources. And how will that pay off and how will it work?
That's the million-dollar question. I personally have no idea. I agree with you.
Well, I was going to bring something actually that was connected to Michael's question in the back, is something that we spoke with privately, which was about how innovation and technology in space, things that we can't even conceive of yet, could change all of these dynamics that we're potentially talking about, right? About like, I think right now, it's interesting how we're framing this conversation a lot, and I think this is natural in actually international political terms, right, or international relations terms. Hence, you know, we're talking about we're looking at as international institutions as potential frameworks for how it will work in space, right, because of all these questions about jurisdiction. But the one thing that we didn't really talk about was how, and you were speaking about this earlier, about free energy and physics and how innovation potentially changed some of the dynamics that we don't have to transport everything everywhere. And maybe you can speak a little bit about that.
I'm really good at getting myself into trouble. If you, yeah, I mean, as a physicist, right, it's very easy to be reductive and say, well, it, you know, it really all boils down to energy and atoms or energy and molecules. So we talked about air and water, sort of, I guess I brought that up kind of flippantly, but also energy. Once you're able to get to a point where you have, you know, free energy in both in a couple of senses, sort of the physics sense of energy to be able to do work on the environment, but also like, I also think of that like the emotional free energy, right? Of like being able to devote your own personal resources to other endeavors beyond making sure you have enough water and air and food for the day. That's, I think, the beginning of the bootstrapping to the point where you eventually have a system around you where you can have an appendectomy in space, where everything doesn't have to come from Earth and all your medicine doesn't have to come from Earth. It's all being generated outside of the gravity well. The physicist in me says that's the key to what Kyle was talking about earlier, where you have these shifts in society, like these periods of stability and then a rapid change, right? I don't know what that energy generation system would have to be. But the crux of the problem is always energy because I'm a physicist.
Can I just riff on that really quickly? And it goes back to the last question as well, but we talked about this a little bit in our preparation for this, but there's a famous essay, many of you probably read it, from the 1930s by Keynes, called Economic Possibilities for Our Grandchildren. If you've not read it, it's actually one of the most mind-boggling essays that somebody that brilliant could make these predictions about the future that were both extremely right and extremely wrong. Extremely right that productivity would keep increasing, and extremely wrong that people would then use that to work less. And I think what's sort of disconcerting about that is that even if we have sort of a revolution where we can harness free energy in ways that we can't even imagine now, the result won't necessarily be that people will work less or have it easier. We'll probably find new things to do in space to keep working too hard and chasing more than we really need.
I would love to ask Kelly a question if I can. Going back to biobanking and the value of information, right? In your expertise, if you talk about a biobank, the fundamentally most valuable information, is it the genomics or is it the knowledge of the more complex systems, the interplay of an ecosystem, like at a high level, or is it is the real gold in like the genomic information, or it's some mix of the two?
It's what you can do with it. So, I mean, right now, the most immediately obvious profitable use is in the medical industry. So it's just that you can come up with treatments, for instance, that are maybe tailored to certain populations, in that, you know, you really got people there because they all want to live. And so this could be extremely profitable to come up with an innovation in that area. But, you know, that's just right now. I mean, there's all kinds of speculation on the horizon about, you know, biobanking not just human genomic information, but what about microbiomes in the soil? What about microbiomes inside animals? These are all things that people are trying to think of ways to get profit out of right now.
I mean, that would be extraordinarily valuable, you know, once we get off the planet, right? Having that is maybe the most valuable thing, the most sought after, right? The thing that people would fight over.
Yeah. I mean, when I think about what's valuable in space, it's not so much like minerals or actual things. It's how we plug a thing into a process of use that ends in a goal that people care about. And what people care about is totally weird, like with the sugar example, you know. And you know, there's no saying how it's going to change in space. For instance, there, you know, in animal behavior research, there's this dichotomy of the field and the lab. In the field, animals behave in ways that make sense evolutionarily because it's their naturally occurring context. In the lab, you get to exert control, but you may be causing sort of artificial artifacts in their behavior. When people go into space, it's gonna be a little bit like going from the field into the lab, and we don't know what we're gonna find. I mean, in the like 1930s, some experiments to find what is an animal's instinctual inheritance is you just raise a lone animal in a room by itself with no other conspecifics. So these are called Caspar Hauser experiments after the feral child. And animals start acting pretty weird when you do that to them. So people might act pretty weird on some long haul spaceships too.
So I think that's a good way to end it is like, what do we value, right? And thinking about that not only today, but also for the future. So thanks very much again for all your contributions and for the audience.